My name is Sylvia.
Kendall.
Natalie.
Yaya.
Delicia Rashad.
And we wanted to talk to you today about women expectations. Mm-hmm. I was telling the girls how I was at a recent family function, and my grandfather was talking to me and my cousin. He's a male. And he was like, so it's about the time you go ahead and get married. It's about that time you go ahead and make sure that you have babies, you know, get your life going. And I was like, but I like working. He was like, oh, well, I was like, isn't Daron older than me? But why were we working for, or I'm sorry, why aren't we waiting for Daron to get married and you're sitting here waiting on me? And he's like, well, he's a guy, so it's okay. He's like living his life out, you know, and you have to get started early. And I'm like, well, I feel like technology's around. I feel like, you know. I can freeze them if I need to. There are other options for me if I absolutely want to. And right now, it's honestly not even on my brain. So, to be completely honest, I was just sitting there. I was like, dang, bro. Like, I can't even live my life.
Like that poem that Beyonce has in her Pretty Hurts video, like at the beginning, where she's like, women or girls are taught to aspire to marriage, but boys aren't.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, you asking us a Beyonce question.
I was like, you don't know.
I was like, who is
Ashley Flawless? That's flawless. Beyonce, she can get 2 high fives. She's really good at her job.
Okay, we make it steps. We make it move.
You know what I'm saying? She's really good at her job. I'm not going to.
She's amazing. But this isn't about Beyonce.
It isn't.
It's not.
I was like, wait.
So was it like that for you though? Did you feel that pressure, Kendall, to like?
Yes, absolutely. I would not have gotten married as early as I did, and maybe not even at all, if I hadn't had that pressure growing up. Mm. For sure. Like, I know that for a fact. But
where did it come from?
Religion is a big issue. Well, because you guys know that I grew up in a very conservative religion that. Like most Christian denominations teach to not have sex until you get married. And so everybody gets married early. So y'all
need to get on Christian crack. Christian crack. That's what that is. Christian crack. Stop doing that. Really, please stop doing that.
Jesus said 3 weeks ago we should get married.
Right? It's always
I was all for it. I don't know what you guys' problem was.
I mean, you're still kind of for it, though. I can't do Christian crack. I get some people that, you know, they fall in love and 2 weeks later, like, they're really in love and they'll be married for 50 years. But I just, there's something that bothers me in the fact that you are getting married for the purpose of having sex.
Yeah.
To me, it means that you don't understand what sex is. Because you don't get married to have sex. That's not the
you
reason
don't.
Why you get married.
I was like, again, things I'm confused about.
I don't know why.
But I agree with, like, the pressure from, like, religion to be, like, a woman, like, we need a man, you know what I mean, to protect us, to provide, and all that stuff. I was talking to Sylvia about how growing up in the church, they pressure, or they push Proverbs 31 on women, like, what? How do I become a woman? They're like, let me tell you about these 10 verses in the entire Bible. And it sums up the woman that you're supposed to be. And it's like, you take care of everyone else before, you know, yourself. She works, but it's like, she works in the home.
Yeah.
That's always like the loophole.
Like that's an honor.
Yeah.
Not like, to say that it's not for those who do choose to live their life that way, but to preach this idea that that is the pinnacle of life for women is very disturbing.
Or like the only...
Yeah,
the only
option, and you're not serving your purpose if you're not cooking.
They don't know what to do with single women,
birthing kids, and the
kids. They don't. The church doesn't know what to do with single women, with single people. They're just like
they just don't want
you're single. You must not be living in your purpose because you're single. I'm like,
that's not even just religion or church. That's like family too, because like every other day, my mom is like. So, I want grandchildren. I'm like, okay, that's nice. You got grandchildren money?
Right.
How am I supposed to do this? Like, and I'm telling her, like, if I just start dating somebody, she's like, oh, keep them around. I'm like,
dang.
Can I just have fun? Can I just date and have fun? Is that an option for me?
That's not okay. You're not allowed to have fun as a woman.
And it's like,
what is that?
What is fun? And then if, like, another thing is if you're a woman who's dating, you're automatically a hoe. And it's like, no, I'm just single. I'm just single and living my life. I'm doing the same thing that he's doing.
Right.
Are you?
So we're all.
I'm probably doing a little bit more.
Every
I'm probably a little bit more extra.
Single.
So, Kendall,
why don't you agree with the word or term hoe existing?
Because I think it's sexist, misogynist. I think women should be able to express themselves and live their life.
Men could be hoes.
Well,
too.
First, I mean, I just don't like the connotations of the word.
Yeah.
Should be able to live their life the way that they want. And then two, especially the way that men live it. Like, sex is for everybody. It's not just for males.
Amen.
And not, like, how do you think you got here? Like, yeah. I don't understand. So, I just don't believe in it. I think that women should have the freedom to live life the way that they want to do it and express their sexuality in whatever way that they choose.
You be a sexy beast.
Yeah, you right, though.
But that's, like, another thing, though. Like, women are expected to talk about things like masturbation. It's like, they do that too? Oh, what? Yeah. You know what I mean? It's like so shameful, but like a dude, you know what I mean? I'm like, I'm sure that growing up, you know, guys have that talk, like, I had a wet dream, and it's just like, oh, that's awesome, you're becoming a man.
Do they?
If I was ever like,
I can see that.
What? Well, I grew up with cousins. Like, I had that, like, it's not taboo, like, for guys to sit around and talk about that type of stuff. Yeah. And even, I think, coming to a parent and telling them, like, you know what I mean? Like, I had that. But if someone were to walk in and be like, so, mom, I started masturbating. If you're a girl, they're going to be like, what the fuck is wrong with you? Yeah, it's just, like, naughty thing, you know what I mean, for women to be sexual beings, so.
Yeah. Touching on that, like, I just recently had to do an interview with a classmate about our sexual history. And we start off when, you know, adolescence, teen years, whatever like that. And during, like, teen years, she was, like, you know, asking about masturbation. And then I realized, like, I mean, I'm putting myself out there. I've been masturbating for a long time. And, like, I was, like, but when I was younger, like, she was asking, like, did you feel shame or, like, guilty about it? And I was like, I did. And she's like, why? I was like, because I just knew that it was wrong. But, like, why? Why was that wrong?
Yeah. You were taught that.
And in Christianity, it almost seems counterproductive. Like, you don't want them to
have
but they can't even take care of it themselves. It's like, I don't know. It's just very weird. I think it's healthy.
Well, religion, they put it all towards, it starts with the mind. And it's, if you already sinned here, you're kind of like, at the end of the day, you're like, well, if I already sinned here, I might as well just
keep on going. So you don't want me to be human. That's how I honestly feel. And I feel like this isn't a conversation about religion, but as a woman, young girl, female, growing up in Christianity, I did find it to be very oppressive.
It is.
So
I think it's a lack, people don't want honesty and
authenticity.
there's something lacking in that community, and that, okay, now that we believe in whatever we believe in, now we have to live up to this standard. Mm-hmm. And but we're never allowed to fall below that, which is to me a contradiction to what the book even says. But yeah, we're expected to live at this certain place, and sex in particular and masturbation is not allowed at all. And they just push you in a box, and then it's kind of, I don't know, it is very oppressive. It's very oppressive. I have not had the same experience, but I also didn't grow up in Christianity. Mm. And when I made choices for myself, like, I'm abstinent, so I don't have sex with people. And I do that because of my belief in God or whatever. But it's like, if I do have sex with someone and I bring it up to someone that's close to me, I never got shot down and was like, you're a horrible person. Look at all this sinning that you're doing, whatever. She was like, how are you feeling? Are you okay? Are you good? Mm-hmm. It was a conversation, and then I moved on with my life. And I feel like it all starts in relationships and honesty with people. And is the community that you have around you, are they looking out for you and what's best for you?
Right.
And not getting caught up in the religious, the church, mm-hmm. all of that. Because mm-hmm. I don't think that Christianity in itself is so oppressive. I think people
make it that way.
Mm-hmm. And it's like this, and I mean, going along with what you were talking about, like your family wanting you to have babies or whatever, I feel like humans like have this need to control people.
Mm. It's weird.
We want to control.
I think you become uncomfortable when somebody's doing something different from you.
Yeah.
That's really what it is. Or like you're fearful of your bubble and your reality being, I don't know, changed in a way, impacted in some kind of way. So to fight against that, to defend yourself and your space, you're like, no, you need to do things the way I want you to do.
Yeah, right.
And it's like, no.
It's like, no.
You never mind it like that.
Mm-hmm. You really can't. I was surprised when my sisters came to me and they're like, I'm trying to be an auntie. I said, what? I'm like, you're that's young. Nice. You're not even like an old person trying to tell me to have kids. Like,
it's not that great.
But
expensive.
Expensive. And I work with kids, so I'm like, first of all, I got the best birth control out there, and second of all, I got 2,000 kids. No, I don't want any kids. I don't even know if I want kids at all anymore. Mm-hmm. And it's like, it's this assumption that every woman wants a child, or this assumption that every woman is gonna walk the same path, and it's just not true.
Yeah,
it's just literally not true. So just stop doing that.
Go ahead.
You first.
Well, on that, like, my thing was, I do want kids. I really do. I don't really care so much about getting married. And so I had a donor. And my mom was not okay with that. She's like, you're really going to do that? Like, by yourself? You know how hard it is? I'm like, yeah, I know it's hard, but that's less stress. I can't deal. I can't have two children. I just want one.
For me, one of the... Like, even though I've gotten over a lot of other stuff, for me now, one of the challenges I face is being an entrepreneur and a business owner and also having a child. That's very challenging, because people have expectations of you as a mother that you're going to be there 100% of the time. And not to say that Avery is not obviously a top priority for me, but you know, when you're on this journey, you got to prioritize your time. So I do get a lot of criticism for that, but at the same time, I just manage. Like everybody else. Balance my time. Make sure that he never has to doubt that mommy loves him, but also making sure that my business is flourishing, because it's going to flourish.
Amen. Sprinkle it.
Amen to that.
Sprinkle.
Speaking of you working and being an entrepreneur, how do we feel about societal expectations of women in the workplace?
Specifically, maybe.
I had this director. He wanted me to be his secretary so bad, and I'm like, no, I'm not getting your pen and paper. Like, why? Just because it wasn't just isolated for me. Like, this is generally how we treated all the women in the office, that, you know, speaking over them, interrupting them, you know, I don't know, just zero consider. And it's just so annoying. Like, you ain't that smart anyway. It's too much. So, I mean, and then being in corporate America and being Black and a female is, you know, a whole another thing entirely.
Mm-hmm. But, yeah, a whole conversation about that.
We can have a whole separate podcast number 85. It's going to be about that. So,
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like society definitely expects that you, like, get married, you have kids, and then your career comes last. And I just felt like that never resonated with me, and I didn't want that. And I want to be a stay-at-home mom at some point in my life. Mm-hmm. I would like to not work. I feel like that sounds like a good idea. Let me take a break and be with my kid when I decide to have a kid, if I decide to have a kid. But it was like, even, I don't know, it's like you just make a choice for yourself that you are going to do what's best for you.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And you're going to move in the timing in which you need to move. For me, it's like the speediness in which I need to be doing things. Like, right, like your clock is ticking.
You're almost ready. You need to, like,
get this going. And I'm like, first of all,
get this going.
I am 27. Like, I have life to live. Hopefully, God willing, I have life to live. And I don't. But I just don't feel the need to be married right now. And I resent the people that taught me that growing up, because when I was 15, I had a plan in my mind that I was going to be married by 22, kids by 25, whatever by 30. But that's not the way that life works. Like, no one told me, hey, no one else knows what they're doing either. Right. Everyone else is making it up as they go along. Mm-hmm. And you don't have to follow these stupid rules that people made up for stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, that's dumb.
I think it becomes a real issue too when you start to set those expectations and you don't hit every single expectation and every goal.
Yes.
Then you start feeling like you're failing at life and you need counseling because you just get all emotional. Right. I'm not saying it's real for me, I'm just saying.
She's like, I'm speaking for a friend.
No, a friend of a friend. Yeah.
I'm just saying.
Yeah. You just kind of feel like, well, dang, I'm not hitting the mark, you know?
Yeah.
And that's.
Oh, I was just going to. We were talking about women at work, or working women, And it's really funny because there's a lot of research that shows women as leaders are very effective in the workplace. Yeah. And yet, I think I mentioned that, I don't know who I was talking to, but like of like Fortune 500 companies, only 5% are actually run by women, mm-hmm. but they're responsible for 20% of the growth. And it's like, come on. We need to encourage women to, I think we need to encourage women to like figure out what makes them happy, figure out what they want in life, figure out how they can be, you know, the best version of themselves so that they can give to those around them.
I think though a part of that is worrying about intimidating men, you know, like
I ain't got time. And,
I ain't got time either. But it's a real thing, you know what I mean? Like
not my world.
Well, no, I was saying not my problem.
Yeah.
No. Like your ego is your problem.
It is.
Like I'm not taking responsibility for that.
Yeah. Like, and I think I think sometimes as women we're conditioned to kind of like shy away,
not go
for things because it's like sometimes I think about I'm like, because I've had men basically tell me like you're intimidating to me, and I'm like, I'm not doing anything in life.
Same.
Like, I was like, I don't even. Like, I don't feel like I'm
because
doing
you're
all
outspoken
the...
and you're confident.
Yeah, and I'm just
you're
like
unapologetic about being.
And I'm just
really
like for real. So then I'm like, do I shrink back? And I was like, I don't have time for that. So I'll just continue. But for some women. Who idolize, because I did used to idolize marriage and all those things, are willing to bite that bullet and be like, hey, I'm not going to get a man if I'm running my own company.
Right.
I'm a CEO. You know, I'm all these things. And so some women, because they idolize this idea of marriage and all that stuff, will be like, it's cool. I'll do some bullshit. I'll shrink back. I'll do whatever to get a man. And it's just like, you know.
Like, I don't have my own opinion on things. I just like what he likes. I just go with the, and I'm like, it's, bro, what?
What about like, you? Like, you're an individual for a reason. Like, you're unique on purpose.
You're, yes.
Say it louder.
Yes. Say it louder for the people in the back.
No, like, you're an individual for a reason. Yeah. You're unique on purpose. So why let go of your individuality just to, and is he really making you that happy? Like,
probably not.
Just wondering.
Your positivity.
Plus well, you know, I like. I wish I had this conversation like so many years ago because I literally put off going to grad school because of the guy that I was dating. Like, I literally was like, okay, I'm not gonna go to grad school. We're gonna be moving to Spain. That's just. That's what's gonna happen. I don't know what's gonna happen in Spain, but we're just gonna go.
Spain it is.
And like now, I'm like. Like, every time, like, I'll date somebody and the things are going well, and then he's like, oh, well, I gotta move. Bye.
That's the thing. I'm not being negative, but that's, like, a reality that a lot of women prioritize their relationship over the things that will make them happy. And that's a problem. Mm-hmm. And it just goes back to the whole idea that you need to figure out yourself and, like, do you and be happy on your own.
That's the thing. I have dudes get pissed off at me all the time because I don't make time for you.
Oh my God.
I work a lot and I love my job and I have goals. I want to buy a condo. I have goals, you know? So, I mean, if you can fit in, then get in. But I don't.
Where you?
I'm not going to sit here and try to make you. Like, I was talking to somebody the other day. I was like, look, I got 2 days off this month. Like, which one do you want to try for?
Which one did you want? 10 and 12 like, on Saturday.
Like, you work every single day. I was like, no, I do OT. Almost every single day. I make money and
there's
I'm happy. I do what I want. So if you're going to be mad at me about it, I'm sorry. I'm not trying to make time for you. But
on the flip side, guys are going to sit there and say, oh, I don't want no girl who's just after my money, blah, 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 blah. She got
to
have
but
her own. But
they don't want
her
to work.
They don't want you to work.
There's a difference between if you want to date and you have a busy life, but you want a relationship, then you make that a priority and you make time to date someone. Dang. You don't just say, oh, I'm busy, pick one of the days. And, like,
you know, but they've already been disclosed that they're just my friend, so I don't know why.
Well,
see,
that particular person
is
breaking,
why I just
yes.
say no.
This is like, called me a man eater the other day. I was like,
Sylvia,
a man eater?
Sylvia,
a man eater?
Never.
Oh,
actually,
well,
no,
don't even. Anyways.
Yeah, I'm like, not a little bit.
Did you guys see that? I think there was like a hashtag going around calling, it was like dress like a woman or whatever.
Whatever
I forgot. Someone, basically, a comment was made about how women should dress in a certain, like, business or, you know, like, in a certain surrounding. And so this, like, hashtag, I guess I was the only one on Twitter reading it, but it was, like, dressed like a woman. But I guess none of you guys. So.
I was like,
talk about
topic.
It.
But,
yeah.
basically the expectation of, you know, women, how we should dress in the workplace, and like, what does that even look mean? Like,
oh, what was that I read? It was a blog that I read like 2 years ago. It said everything considered professional is really based on what is white and what is male.
Yep. Yeah,
that's
and I was like,
true.
That is so true. Like,
yeah, pretty much.
No, I don't want to.
No, I don't want to wear that. I'm so glad I have the job that I have now.
Yeah,
now that I'm like thinking about that, because I'm like, well, and people used to always tell me that about tattoos too. Like, you have tattoos, like, you're not going to be able to work in this place and that place. I was like, but what if I don't want to work there?
Right.
You are automatically assuming that that
yes.
is the type of person that I want to be.
Exactly.
And I don't.
Or telling you to dress for the job that you want. But maybe I don't want to actually be here. This is kind of like a
stepping stone.
Right. Yeah.
So I'm dressed for the job that I want.
I like to dress for the job that I want.
But this is the job that I need right now.
Right. This is the job that maybe that's why I always wear sweatpants, because deep down inside, I do want to be a stay-at-home mom.
Perfect.
Maybe that's a thing. I don't know.
It could be.
Or, it could be.
Or sweatpants are just really comfortable.
Or both.
Or both.
Or both.
That is a thing.
It's true. Mm-hmm. I wear sweatpants almost every day. And I am
not
proud.
About it.
So your choice or your desire to be a stay-at-home mom, do you feel like that's pressure from society being like, oh, you should be at home with your kids? That's just, or...
No. I grew up with a mom that was never there. My mom was always working. And I ended up having to take care of my sisters and learning how to, like, run a household. And I kind of enjoyed it. And I thought to myself, like, if I have kids, maybe not a stay-at-home mom for, like, their whole life, but if I had kids, I want my kids to, like, know that I was going to show up to their dance recital or their talent show, or be able to, like, help out in the classroom or things. Like, there were times that I wanted my mom to do that, or I was in a show or something. I didn't know who was going to show up or if someone was going to show up. And I don't want my kids to feel that way. Just because that was a huge thing for me, being raised in a single parent home. It's really hard to be a single mom. And my mom did the best job that she could, and I love her. I love you. but that's the way that it affected me. And so, no, it's not from any sort of pressure. I just, I want to do that. And I'm like low-key lazy sometimes. And I want to sleep.
Sometimes.
Like, no, in real life, I value sleep. Not that I think I'm gonna have
a conversation yesterday.
I'm telling you. And it's not that I think life is easy as a stay-at-home mom, or that you're not gonna be up like working with your kids or whatever. But I think there is a certain pressure when you do work in a workplace. Like, you have to meet these goals, or you have deadlines, or whatever. There's just an added stress that I don't necessarily want for my whole life.
Makes sense. Being a stay-at-home mom is a job.
It is a lifetime career.
It really is.
And then there's this notion that women who are in the workforce can't be moms, or can't meet those expectations of being a mom. Like, you're not gonna make it to all the games, you're not gonna, you know, you're gonna have your kid in all these activities just to get them out of the way so that you can just work.
Yeah.
Because, like, we were talking about bad moms, like, the different moms on there. That's how they were treating that one.
Yeah.
I don't remember any of the names of the characters, but
it doesn't matter.
But, you know, the one who was, like, she had the child by herself.
Oh, yeah.
And she was working her ass off, and her child was in all these different activities so that to keep the child busy while she was, you know, still trying to fulfill her goals. And that's kind of, that was frowned on in that film. And I was just like, that was my mama. My mom did it. I don't know how, because
taking
care of me
you
is
just
hard.
Do it.
You just do it.
Like
every other mama, you do it.
And you're never,
I'm a dog
like
mom.
This thing that like moms have to be.
Dog mom.
A dog mom?
I'm a dog mom.
You are a dog mom. I'm a cat mom. But moms don't have to be the best mom.
What does that even mean?
Like,
mom,
right.
What
like,
mean? Like, what is the
like,
best
I have
mom?
To be super mom. Like, I got to be the Pinterest mom, right? Like, I got...
That's
my everything
mom.
Looks cute all
mom.
The time.
I am a mom. Yeah.
Oh, yes.
All his kids get Valentine's baskets. Like, all the kids in his class get little candies. See, that's the thing. For me, it's like, okay, I know that my time is limited, so let me make the most of the time that I do have with him. So, like, weekends that I have him, I make sure that he's my priority those weekends. And if I need to do something critical, then I do that other thing. But for the most part, he knows when he's here, he is the priority. We go to Disneyland, and it's great. So,
discerning that is great.
So,
I feel like that's how it's supposed to be, though.
Yeah, like, I just rather have, like, quality time than, like, you see me every day and it's me running around stressing out and I'm upset. Like,
yeah.
You know, you're going to see mommy. We're going to read before bed every night. We're going to, you know.
Yeah. You give them a routine. Mm-hmm. And you give them, you are the ones that are setting the expectation for your own child about mm-hmm. what he should be receiving from you. And mm-hmm. it's not coming from all these other sources of, like, mm-hmm. oh, because, I mean, you watch TV, we watch movies, like.
They make it seem so
they make it seem like the mom has to be, you know, this figure. And it's mm-hmm. like, no, that's not what happens in
I
real life.
I can slip up, too.
The other part, like, setting an example for him, like, if he did fall in love with someone, with a woman or man who's industrious, for him to be comfortable with that and be used to that and understand that, you know, that's okay. You can be industrious and you can work hard and you mm-hmm. can still be happy and have a good relationship.
Can mm-hmm. we talk about that for a second? Because I feel like when I learned about relationships as a child, it was always displayed to me as I am that other person's half. That's my other half. Mm-hmm. And as I grew up and started thinking about it, I was like, that makes zero sense.
I feel like we're so two.
Like,
we're
two of us.
Yeah. So we're two.
Two of us are going to make one. That don't make no sense. Like, I need to be my own full person, and mm-hmm. you need to be your own full person. And we can complement each other.
Mm-hmm.
We
like
can
that.
Support each other in life. We can be partners in this.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But to say that I have to be your other half means, to half me, I hear that and I go, I got to cut out a part of me and who I am to be able to mold and fit to you. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if I like
that. I think that's exactly what it was meant to be, mm-hmm. though. I think that's exactly how it was meant to be taken, that you're supposed, as women, you're only supposed to go so far, and then the man is supposed to take over. Because the way that they're raised is that they're supposed to be the provider, they're the protector, they're all these things. They're supposed to be this whole person, and they're supposed to, like, save us. Like,
and that's so much unfair pressure on men.
From yourself.
Saving from being a woman. That is an unfair burden on men that you have to come save us all.
But that's like kind of like, how
why would you do that to people?
It was really funny because I went on a date with this guy and I was telling him, he was like, yeah, you need somebody to mow the lawn. I was like, why? I could do that on my own. Right. And he was like, see, y'all women take, you know, the responsibility away from the man. I was like, yeah, then you have to actually be a decent human being.
Right.
I'm not relying on you to do all these things that I can do for myself.
Exactly.
Like, you have to actually be good
that
for me.
Scares
me.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That scares me.
He was like,
I only had mowing the lawn.
He's like, I had mowing the lawn.
Every Saturday morning, that was going to be
taking
me.
Taking out the trash.
Now I don't know what to do.
And that's not to say that, well, this isn't a dating show. But anyway. Yeah. So that, it was just really interesting because I think when you take away all those superficial things and like those gender roles, mm-hmm. it's like you're finding someone who actually complements you
mm-hmm.
and not fits this role that you're looking for, which mm-hmm. is really
well,
weird.
That's why you gotta find somebody who has the same mindset because these guys, they're still on this, all these girls don't know how to cook these days. Your mama didn't teach you how to cook. Your mama didn't teach you how to cook. So what have you been doing? What have you been doing at home? Just starving?
Yes.
That could be why I'm single. I don't know how to cook. Putting it out there.
That's
what
not.
Was that?
I don't know.
I
know how to cook.
I know how to cook.
And I'm
how to cook.
So
I can cook.
But the thing is, anybody can learn. So like, if you don't know how to cook, like,
girl, let me tell you. When me and my ex were breaking up, when we were in the process of breaking up, I stopped cooking for him. This fool was really, he put chips and dip in a bowl and served up and ate it.
No, I have seen guys make the weirdest stuff. We used to live in a house, me and Sylvia used to live in a house with all these guys. And we woke up one morning and he had a cup of noodles with like a smidge of peanut butter on the side.
What? That's cute.
And a banana. I said, what are you doing? He was like, well, this is all I could come up with. That's it. So
it
then,
was probably Bob.
That was upstairs. So then I come downstairs and catch another fool trying to make Alfredo sauce out of ranch. And I said, You know what? Go
that's
ahead and put that
thing.
Down.
That's not a
I'm going to go ahead and cook for you because that's disgusting.
So your mama failed you, in other words.
But wait, isn't that reiterating?
Like
okay, I was like, at Daddy, I was like, isn't that reiterating what we're trying to get away from?
Yeah.
Was you asking, did their mama teach
well,
them how to cook?
A, I was younger. But B, the one upstairs, I left him alone with a cup of noodles and peanut butter. But the one downstairs actively
Alfredo
trying to turn ranch into Alfredo. I said, you know what, let me help you. Let me just take this
take
off.
That away.
We're going to start with some butter and some flour. We add in the milk. Like we.
See, that's even
the funny thing is my dad is the one who taught me how to cook.
Yeah.
Same. But my dad, I think a lot of it, when I was younger, I always felt like my dad was trying to make me, like, domesticated. Like, he'd have me baking cakes and cooking.
I'm just like, he was literally, that was our activity for the weekend. Easy bake oven,
your body in the kitchen.
That, yeah.
Did you teach you how to vacuum?
Oh, no. My mom had me doing that. I was Cinderella at home.
My dad was opposite. He had me building cars with him.
Yes, we that was my life.
That's what I did with my mom. My life dynamic was all jacked up. It was all backwards.
I love that. Even today, me and my dad, we talk about, like, tools and, like, cars.
Heck yeah. I just changed my brakes with my dad, and he's like, so surprised. He's like, Natalie, you're, like, mechanically inclined. I said, well, it's not pretty rocket easy. Science. It's not rocket science. I got it. It was like this. But he also, my dad never, he taught me, I think, how to be an independent woman. And we clashed a lot on that because he wanted me to be a certain way when I was younger. But I think he also realized, oh, she can take care of herself. And I know that I'm not going to have to worry about her. And he doesn't. He knows I could live my life. I'm fine.
I don't think my mom has any expectations of me.
She said that earlier.
I'm being serious. Like, I don't think I've ever felt pressured to do anything.
But that's kind of
she just allows you to do herself,
she just
though.
Allows me, kind of. I think she'd be secretly praying, like,
Lord,
go this way.
Reverse it.
But I don't think she's ever been, like, I think, like, jokingly, like, she's been, like, you know, have kids, but she know I couldn't. So she just knows, like, I couldn't. Those poor kids.
Oh.
This time in my life, I don't need kids. I need an actual babysitter. So, but I don't think I grew up having those expectations. Even, like, thinking of this, like, what we were talking about, I was like, I don't know if all these expectations are necessarily, like, as taboo as or as big. So I think that women nowadays have tons of role models and access to things that allow us to be what we want to be.
Yeah, for sure.
And that it's not necessarily, you know, like back in, you know, the good, you know, back in the day. You know what I mean? Like back in the day where it was very much like, if you're a woman, like you barely maybe even got out of high school. College wasn't a thing. Like you were, you know, taught to, when you grow up, you're going to be someone's wife, you're going to be a mother, and I don't think that we necessarily grow up in that time.
Well, yeah, you know what I mean? It's like a widespread thing. Like
no,
it's
I think that we have a lot of power and a lot of...
Heck yeah.
Yeah. I'm glad we had that transformation, though. I was talking to my aunt about my grandmother, and the one thing that she taught me was when my grandfather cheated on her, she said, well, Sylvia, whatever you're doing to make him upset, to make him cheat, you just have to stop. Just keep that in mind. And I was like, oh, and this is the thing. Back then, he was the breadwinner, you know? He was the provider. He was the protector. She had all boys. Like, it was like, she didn't have anything else other than him. She barely finished. I think she checked some college button. So, like, like she didn't have everything in the world available to her, especially because it was, like, way, way back when. And I was thinking about it the other day. I was like, dang, like, how unfortunate my grandmother's life had to be to sit there and just feel like she had nowhere else to go and nothing mm-hmm. else to lean back on other than a husband who was unfaithful, mm-hmm. but she had kids, so she had to make sure she stayed obligated to at least her kids and stayed in the relationship. I mean, who knows? She maybe just was like, hey, you know what? It's okay. We can work it out.
'Cause it's part of
that's not me, mm-hmm. but we can work it out. So that's a choice that she made. But I mean, thinking about that and then thinking about where I'm at and how I'm like, if he cheats, snip. So, like, I just feel like I'm like, and I think that's another reason why I became so self-efficient and why I work so hard and why I've always just been a worker is because I'm like, I'm not willing to let another person be the reason why I make it or break it. Like, mm-hmm. I'm not going to have that happen. So, like I said in the last podcast, you ain't going to have a chance. So, you're not going to have a chance. I have my own money. I have my own savings. I have my own apartment. I have my own car. I have my own bills paid and great credit. I'm going to do what I want to do. Hey. And I'm going to live my life the way co-signer. I want to live it because I can't.
That credit score looking like.
But I can't live that life again.
She's like,
I can't
remove
that. And I refuse to be another person in my family to be the same type of woman. Like, I'm not going to be the same. I'm going to own properties. I'm going to live my life.
Hey,
so
just don't forget about us. Well, yeah. You know what I'm saying?
She ain't forgetting about us.
No.
She don't take us
back. But I was thinking about this. So while we're over here encouraging one another, we do realize that there's also a part of society where women tend to turn against one another. And we compete. It's not, and you see with us, we're not trying to do one up on one another. We're just like, hey,
we're
let's,
not.
Let's stick to
it. Are we not?
Oh my gosh.
Are we not? We won't want to say
no, but we're not trying to like beat one another and everything. We're trying to support one another and uplift one another and exhort one another. Yeah, but it's not always like that, you know?
She's like, I want to be
like women truly fight.
No.
Yeah. Like because, and I think it goes back to a couple things. Like
let me
a couple things.
First, not understanding your worth. You're not competing with anybody. Like
but
you know,
say
right?
That.
But yourself. If you know your worth and you speak to that and you live according to that, just because he chooses her has nothing to do with you, like at all. And I'm obviously speaking specifically about relationships. And then I don't remember what the other one was, but aspiring to relationships, like believing that that's like your purpose in life, so you gotta have somebody because you wanna be able to say, I got somebody, and you don't. Like, it's.
Yeah.
It's stupid.
But this is the thing. I could have somebody, I just don't want nobody. Can that be okay too?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's gonna totally be okay. But yeah, I think.
More boys for me.
Love it.
More boys for me.
But yeah, pitting women against each other is, when you recognize it, for the first time, you start to see how many times it happens. Mm-hmm. How many times it happens. Like, even with Melania Trump, whoever, that lady. The first lady. I'm sorry.
It's like
Melania.
Not
Ivanka.
Melania.
Yes.
Oh, I never made that reference.
These poor women.
But people.
No, it has nothing to do with her.
But okay, but people were trying to bring up like her old photos, like her old was brought up and stuff, and they were shaming her for that.
Oh, wow.
Like feminists, right, that are supposed to be like, we're for women, we love all women, do whatever you want in life. And I'm like, okay, but she did what she wanted
her.
In life.
So again?
I get maybe this is the first time this has happened for the first lady. I understand the dynamic there, but I'm like, especially for people that are so outspoken about everyone just being able to be themselves and live in their truth, that quote that everyone says, for you then to go after that woman for those pictures that she took is so hypocritical. I can't really wrap my mind around that.
I feel like women tend to forget that there are so many different shades of feminism. Like, there were different waves of feminism. Like, there was like the whole sexual liberation, and it was like the girl right or whatever, women wearing pants, that I think that was before, but you know, like, there's so many different waves, and different women carry or ride on the different waves of feminism. Like, I am all for sexual liberation, fuck who you want to, protect yourself, and, you know, have fun. Like, it doesn't have to be about love, whatever. And then there are, like, even before her, the first lady, I'll just say that, they're like, people, I know y'all love to hate her, but Beyonce.
I don't hate her.
Okay.
Can we just dispel this rumor? I don't
hate
Beyonce.
So you guys don't hate Beyonce. Whatever. You just,
I didn't
whatever.
I
y'all
don't
love her either, though.
I guess she's a monster.
Really, I don't hate her.
Okay.
Either way, the same thing with that. Like, people were saying, well, how does Beyonce call herself a feminist and she dresses like that? Like, that's not what feminism is. Feminism doesn't have one face.
Mm-hmm.
And, or one race. That's another thing that, you know, something else. So why can't we just embrace it all? Like, why can't it be like, how come we can't encompass all of these different shades of what a woman can or what a woman is? That was me.
The Beyonce one is hard for me, because when I was sitting at her show and hearing the things that she says, I mostly agree with her. I think being a girl is cool. Awesome. But I also hear her say, like, be you and be who you are and all these things. But I'm, like, watching such a manufactured image of her that's the disconnect for me, is that I understand that is who she is on stage, that's her job and that's who she's trying to be. That doesn't take away that, from my experience, there is a disconnect between
you flashing up feminism on a stage and then you sitting there in like a 30-inch blonde wig looking perfect. And because to me, when I hear someone say to be you and be who you are, I don't think of putting on, I guess, a bunch of things to manufacture this image. Like, I don't know.
That's a Beyonce version conversation.
I don't get that. Because I was thinking about that this week, just in general, because she's in the spotlight.
Yeah.
This is more a conversation point. I'm not trying to, like, you know, defend, but.
Yeah. No, defend her.
People. You have to appeal to people to get them to listen to you.
Yeah.
At the end of the day.
And
you
it's
have
her
to
job.
Create, you have to do something. It's her job. I mean, and it sucks that she grew up in that. Maybe not sucks because now we have Beyonce. But there's a lot of pressure that she's under. And at the end of the day, I'm not sure that people would respond to her the same way and be inspired by her message if she wasn't appealing, which is gross to say. But that's where I'm sitting on now. So I'm just thinking through these things.
But that is completely true because there are other women. Well, and I mean, I guess at the end of the day, Beyonce is allowed to be the type of woman that she wants to be. If that's the image that she wants to create and all that, you know what? Two high fives, more power to you, live your life. But that disconnect did happen for me. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying that she's not allowed to do that. I'm saying that when I watched it, I didn't understand it. Now, did it probably expand my understanding of feminism and who she's allowed to be and how I define what a woman is supposed to be? Yeah, she pushed me on that. Mm-hmm. I give her props and credit for that because I probably did shut her down a lot because I was like, you're fake. Everything about you is fake. But I don't know. It's something I'm working on, I guess, understanding Beyonce and the whole Beyonce
culture.
Mm-hmm. I didn't necessarily consider myself a part of that for a long time. I think I'm starting to understand it more now. Now I kind of want to be a part of it a little bit.
This is the thing. I support her. But
she's an amazing singer.
But doesn't really it speak more to society that she can't be heard without becoming that?
Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. It's not really about her. It's more about how we're interpreting her and taking her message on that. Yes, agreed.
Yeah.
Dulce has an issue.
She does.
I had an issue with this whole thing. Because it's like, to me, the way it's reading is like you're basically saying that not just Beyonce, but any woman, she can't be, what if being who she is being, you know,
blonde
fake ass, fake tits, blonde hair. Because you mentioned having blonde hair. I'm like, I don't see how that takes away from her being a feminist.
Well, that's why I'm saying.
That's what I'm trying to figure out.
I did not understand her brand of
feminism.
Of womanism or feminism. I didn't understand that because the words that she was speaking, I had a different definition in my mind of what I thought that was.
But I mean,
so there was a disconnect.
Of Beyonce.
Just in general.
But
like,
in general,
so like Amber Rose. Let's say Amber Rose. Would you consider her any less of a feminist because she does her slut walk?
No.
Or
dyes her hair blonde.
So, I mean, what's the difference is what I'm trying to figure out.
Does
Amber Rose
reach
feminism?
Yes.
I don't pay attention to her. I'm sorry.
Yes. Awesome. Well, yeah. And then there's the whole thing with Kim Kardashian. Like,
really?
That's another thing where people pick. Look, we may not love her, but that's the same, you know, storyline is that, she's less of a feminist because of her having a fake ass or her, you know, posting pictures of herself naked and all that stuff. She's a mom. She's all these things. So I'm just trying to figure out what is the difference between these people. They're doing the same thing, but yet you're saying that you couldn't understand with Beyonce.
Maybe.
But like, it happens in so many different dynamics, not just celebrity. Just like the girl next door could be doing it.
I guess.
We can go in order. Let's just
talk. Okay. from what I'm understanding, because we were talking about Beyonce. I don't know if Natalie's necessarily saying that every single woman that we're about to bring up that has to deal with feminism is that way. She's saying that prior to that experience and in dealing with that experience, that's what she understood. But then she opened up her eyes to what you are now saying, which is there are multiple faces to feminism. So she's not saying that she still thinks that way. She's saying now she understands that, but you're going back to, you know, what she understood in the past, but now she's already opened up.
Yes.
Well, it sounded like you were just talking about Beyonce. That's why I was like,
she was
well,
the conversation.
Saying,
I was talking about her.
She was the most.
But
what
I was
getting at is like, if she meant like a general thing, at like, was it like a general belief or was it just with Beyonce? And that's why I was like, well, what's the difference?
I wonder if it's perpetuating this this objectification of women is the issue, is the disconnect. That's what I'm wondering. Because, like, you have to be the way that men expect you to be and look that way before we will listen to you.
Mm-hmm.
What's in here doesn't matter over what's out here, like what you look like. I don't know.
I think I just grew in there was a definition that I had of what being a woman was.
Mm-hmm.
But I still carry that definition. I just now don't apply that definition to everyone else.
Right.
Does that make
sense?
Yeah.
Like, I guess I let go of the fact that I thought maybe that every woman needed to look a certain way or talk a certain way or walk a certain way to be considered a woman that
would be respected.
Is worth respect.
Is worth respect, but also can speak on what feminism is.
I got you.
You know? And that wasn't when I saw, and I'm using Beyonce because Beyonce is thrown in my face 24/7. I got a stupid text message on my phone about her being pregnant. Like, I just don't care that much. And I don't know. I've grown in that.
I think that's okay. Like, you.
Yeah.
You know, you subscribe to whatever fulfills you. Beyonce is amazing to me. That's one of my role models. So I just gonna send you text messages about her.
But back on what you were saying, Kendall, that would still
so
kind of be
3 minutes
imposing your whatever beliefs that you may have on other people, because maybe Beyonce, Kim Kardashian, Amber Rose, they don't feel like they're objectifying themselves.
Mm-hmm.
They feel that's their liberation. Mm-hmm. So even as a woman, you're saying, oh, well, maybe it's because, you know, she's still objectifying herself. Excuse me.
Oh.
That's still imposing your beliefs because they might not feel that way.
Right. I don't think that they
No,
feel
I know,
that
but
way.
I'm just saying.
Oh, okay, but I'm just wondering if maybe that's why some people feel that disconnect.
I definitely think that's, for me at least, I'm not saying that's for every girl out there that's not the way I thought, but for me, that's definitely a thing of like, well, this is the standard of what I think women should be or look like or sound like, and I expected women who are, in a sense, influencing other women to be doing that, and I didn't understand her brand completely. I didn't understand, because of that disconnect, to me, it just didn't make sense. And it still low-key doesn't make sense to me, because I'm like, if you're just going to wake up and be natural, just be natural. Just do you. But that's neither here nor there.
I know this is still not about Beyonce, but Pretty Hurts keep on
coming. I love that.
Coming.
God.
I'm actually tired of talking about Beyonce.
I'm over.
That's my sister.
She does speak about how
many
to where she is, it hurts you. Like, sometimes it's not always what you want, but you have to do what you got to do. So, I mean, I'm not an oh my gosh Beyonce fan, but I definitely,
I love that
song. I could see how it can be a thing. So,
yeah. I have no words.
I don't know. You have no
idea. Ayana's just standing by that. Lemonade was really good, though.
Yeah.
I just like pretty
much. Wow. We might get a lot of comments about your hatred.
Guys, this Beehive week, don't come for
don't.
When Black Girls Brunch. Okay?
No.
It's going to get real.
I don't have time.
Wait, so, guys, we're going to have our rant of the week now, and it's not coming from Yanban. It's coming from Kindle.
So I think in the group, and maybe this podcast probably, I have built this reputation of being a man hater.
Yeah.
Or something.
Yeah.
But the truth is, it's not.
Explain yourself.
Look at the sincerity.
Explain yourself, girl.
Okay. So I'm really not a man hater. But I am anti a lot of things. Anti-misogyny, sexism, condescension. Anti-you. If it ain't, I made it up.
If it ain't, I'm about to use that.
Anti-holding on to somebody who has only come to lie, cheat, and destroy, just so you can say you got somebody.
That's
like anti-treat me like less than I'm a queen. Like, so if being anti all of those things makes me a man hater, like, well,
this makes you a boy hater.
Sorry, not sorry.
That's a boy hater.
That's good. That's good.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know, because I'm 27 and there's some. Grown.
No,
boys.
I think it's great to have standards.
Boys. I guess
tons
they can
of standards, which is why I'm still single.
So, I have tons of standards.
It's just at the end of the day,
they're not requirements, but I feel like you shouldn't do that. Maybe that's smart, you know? Maybe you should think about that before you do it. So, I mean, there are certain things where I feel like it's completely okay to be like, well, maybe. You know what I think? Because
I think men provide balance. I have a son. Like, how can I be a man hater and I have a son? Like, It's not even about that.
Mm-mm. I don't think it's...
No, you know your worth. That's what it is.
Yes, that's exactly what it is that you are unapologetic about who you are and what you want out of life. And it's very rare that you meet that in situations or in conversations with people when you say something offhand and you maybe don't recognize the misogyny in it or the condensation in it or whatever.
Condensation.
Condensation is this though on the glass. I know what it is. But yeah, I think it's just you don't necessarily meet that all the time. And so when you meet it, people automatically go, oh, she must be a man hater because this is my experience of what that definition is.
Or
but it's not that.
Or an angry black woman. And I'm not angry. I'm very happy. And I'm not bitter at all. Like, the men in my life are very important to me. Even like Avery's dad, like, we kick it all the time. Like, I don't hate, it's not even about that. But like you said, just being unapologetic about.
Yes. So Kendall's not a man hater, though.
No, I am not a man. Stop calling me a man hater.
And Sylvia may or may not be a man either, but that's a whole different conversation.
Why?
What?
No, they just.
I want to backspace delete on this.
No, you're not.
Okay, wait. How are we defining man eater?
Please tell me because I just found out that I was one, so I didn't know.
What do you think a man eater is?
Yeah. What?
Well, the definition he told me is he said you literally chew them up and spit them out.
That means they have feelings for you, they expect you to bite, and you don't. And so they're like, oh, I have to sit in this rejection on my own.
The dude that was trying to get at me.
Oh, well, then I tried.
He's just my friend.
I tried.
For a really long time.
Well, he might know you well, then.
Nah,
maybe you're out here eating men.
No.
How is it?
What does it taste like?
No.
I'm just kidding.
I think that it's an expectation of, like, that you have to, what you're saying,
you have to settle. He's like, so whenever you're done with him, you just let him go. And I'm just like, well,
what are you supposed to do?
It's not even like when I'm done with him, I just, you know, we just, maybe we didn't mix well.
And that's
you or maybe, that's yeah, is. And I'm I don't feel it. The need to. Like, I'll date if you want to date, let's live life. But if it's not, if I don't see anything and I'm not going to waste your time either, that's a respect that I have for men as well. I'm not going to just sit here and just be like, oh, okay, let's just eat together and you can pay for my food.
Do they?
Do they? They will waste their time. They just spend their money and waste their time. I'm like, hey, I already told you I don't like you, but all right, free food.
No, see, I pay for my own food on purpose.
Wait, well, we
don't
have to have a conversation.
I know.
Save
some money.
Wait.
I mess around and pay for them sometimes just because I want to prove a point. Like, I don't need you, but if I want you, just
ooh,
know
this
that
is another,
this is...
Ooh,
yeah,
another
that was like a man-eater quote.
Oh, yeah.
She said, I'm proving a point that I don't need
you. I don't need you, but if I want you, just know that it's real. Because if I don't want you, I'm not going to deal with you. Like, there's no point in wasting either of our time. Let's be respectful of both of us, you know? But if I really want you, then bruh. It's real, and I'm here. Let's do this. But if we're not, let's just not. So let's not
make
it.
Dudes want girls to be thirsty for them.
That's not a thing.
So wait, if you pay for the drinks or something, you're a man eater?
No. That's what I'm trying to figure out.
I'm trying to figure out. Is that what people are saying to you?
So what are the boxes
again? Is that what he's really saying to you?
Because the only definition I got was Sylvia, you chew them up and spit them out when you're done. That's all I got. That's all I have.
I can't wrap my head around.
So then maybe it's not a bad thing.
Right?
Good.
I think maybe it's because
I am a man.
Feelings get hurt. Maybe it's because feelings get hurt. Maybe that's what it is.
They're gonna be
it's
right.
Not your fault. I feel like if I disclaim everything in the beginning, you shouldn't be surprised. So
right.
Yeah.
Anyways,
there's this thing called hope.
I know we should all become
people
men.
Be banking on that.
Maybe
I feel like we probably already are.
Yeah, just how women have hope, like
just
all the change.
Just how girls have hope.
He was who he was when you met.
I cannot wait for a change.
That's true.
I will give people benefit of the doubt with that. Like, you may not be the same person that I met 7 years ago. You may not be. Like, stuff happens, you know? So, yeah. I mean, you may have changed. I've changed. I'm not the same. I mean, I'm still quiet.
I mean, look at you right now.
I'm quiet.
I feel like that was...
I'm still 16.
You're a man-eater now.
Oh, my God.
You wasn't a man-eater in high school. Okay.
I'm just saying, I'm not as quiet.
Like Sierra. She did like Sierra, too.
We know that. Listen. We know that. Sorry. Better.
Don't we have
better
than.
Better than.
Liz. But I think it's Liz not a negative... I don't think you should take it negative.
Yeah.
It's a good thing to be a man-eater.
You don't waste your time.
And you don't care about that either.
We don't have
time. They're grown.
We don't have time for F boy tears. They be alright.
No tears for the
F boy tears.
They're gonna be okay.
I don't know. I think it's important to just be, let's just be real, mm-hmm. you know. Yeah. But I'm not the same person I was. I'm kind of quiet, really quiet actually. But when I want to talk, I talk. So like sure. I feel like everybody deserves a chance. Don't get me wrong, guys. Everybody deserves
so
a chance.
So he's like, let me redeem myself.
No, it's not. It's not a well. I think. Everybody kind of deserves a chance. It's like a real thing for me. It's like equal rights.
Equal opportunity.
Just all day. But once we've come to the conclusion, or one of us come to the conclusion that, hey, maybe we shouldn't go any further, then maybe we should respect that.
Yeah.
Maybe we should respect that. And keep on going.
And that's okay, but we could still be cool. But then they don't want to hear that. So then it's just like, well.
If they can't do it first, then it's not okay.
But that's not what this is about. See, that's the issue with pride. I don't have time for pride.
Amen.
Yeah. I don't have time for ego.
But this is why I like us and our friendship.
We don't get married. It
and,
don't
who
be
we, and who we I've are.
All golden girls.
We all
be the chocolate like, girls.
Sylvia gets to be a man eater. Like, Sylvia gets to be a man eater, and you get to be a Beyonce hater, and you're sitting next to Beyonce's sister. All in the same place. Like, we allow each other to be. And,
yes.
And in that way, I think
SCPA,
we
I'm just saying,
literally fulfill, like, that whole women empowering mm-hmm. women thing. I think that we do that really well. I mean, pat on the back.
Yes. Yeah.
Good. I think we actually love each other.
Yeah.
Yes.
Sometimes.
Stop it. Also, but it's kind of rare. Like, I see girls still posting at our age that are like, all I date or hang out with dudes because girls this and this. And I'm like, no female friends.
That's sad.
And it's sad because I'm like, I have y'all. I have like tons of women in my life. And I want that for other women because I think it's important. Yeah. Like, hang out with dudes, I don't judge, you know what I mean? But I think it's important to have strong women and your
better
together
who can really relate to you. Yeah. Like, what are you gonna talk about with a bunch of dudes 24/7?
Well, I mean, you could probably talk about a lot.
Yeah,
talk
about a lot of
like, I'm not about to be like, well, I will have that conversation, but like 24/7 all the time, I'm not gonna be bruh, let me tell you about this period.
Right.
This Red River is killing me.
Like Red River.
They're not going to want to hear that.
Actually, I used to call it the crimson waves.
Right? That's
okay.
Nice.
Well,
I'm so done with you guys.
Backstage, so, guys, we love food. Talk about food.
Oh, okay. So really I cooked today, guys. I made a sweet potato hash with kale.
It's all gone
because I ate it all.
It was amazing.
But I made a couple of vegan ones without any meat in them. And then in the ladies that do eat meat, you guys are, why are you eating it? Like, okay, weirdos. I added bacon and eggs just because that's what
it's
I like
breakfast.
To do.
It's brunch.
It's breakfast, it's brunch. So delicious. I'll probably be posting that recipe for you guys later on this week during the refill.
Awesome. So guys, we know we covered a lot of information. We all have very different opinions, but if you have anything to say, feel free to let us know. Go ahead and thumbs up, subscribe, share. Yes. Please
share.
Live life.
Sharing.
Air over. And then, obviously, you want to follow us on Instagram. You can find us on Instagram, Double Tap Heart. We love you. Live life. And Natalie, go ahead and close
stay
out.
Hydrated, stay moisturized, and as always, stay black.
Bye,
guys.